If you're a first-time guest at Compass, thank you for being here. So glad you kicked off your week with us here. Great to have you. Next week, we're wrapping up our series on Drop the Mic, going kind of through the Sermon on the Mount, this whole new kind of way to be human that Jesus gives us that we've been studying. And it's going to be kind of a decision week, so we do want to encourage you, if you've never been baptized and you would like to be baptized, we would love to celebrate that with you. In Acts chapter 2, Peter preaches the first message for the new church, and the people are cut to the heart, and they ask, what do we have to do to be saved? And he tells them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Christ Jesus. So if you've never done that, we would love to. You heard mentioned earlier, we've got our Compass app. You can go to mycompasschurch.com, find that app. Hey, so now we've set it up, so on that app, you can actually go and have a Connect card digitally there, so that you've got it on your program, and you can always do the actual physical card on the program. But now we've got a digital card. You can always go there as well at any time, and then touch that Connect card portion, and then it'll give you a place you can fill out and make a decision whether you want to know more about Christ or about getting baptized or other stuff right there. You can do that anytime. We just want to encourage you. For some of you, you like a physical card, and you can always fill it out and bring it to us. Some of you grew up on smartphones. That's the only way you do anything, and so we've tried to accommodate you as well. So be sure to use the app and that Connect card digitally as well if you would like to do that at any time, and we will follow up and make sure those things happen. So today, we're in the next to last week of this series. And listen, if you have your Bible and want to go to Matthew chapter 7, you can get there and we'll start there reading in just a moment. So a couple weeks ago, I did a topic on lust, and I thought that's going to be the hardest one for sure. I don't think it is. I think today's theme, and it is on judging, is actually harder. And I would say it's even more scary. And here's why. Because in our culture, we don't tend to even see it anymore. Like most of us don't even recognize it. And here's why I know. So I was thinking about this. Nobody in our room, none of us like to be judged, right? No, us don't judge me. We throw this around. And I remember this. So whenever I was growing up and going to junior high and going to high school back in the middle and late 80s, back at that time, before we were trying to legalize marijuana across all of our states medically and recreationally, way back then when it was completely illegal, it was always the pothead that threw out this verse, right? So they had a life verse, and this was it. It's this section we're gonna read in Matthew chapter 7, do not judge, right? And listen, and even back then, like they only had two verses. That's all they knew. They knew every seed-bearing plant is good, right? And don't judge. That was it, man. That's all they had. I'm smoking, don't judge me. That's all they used, right? Which was totally out of context, but that's what they went with. So listen, I know nobody likes to be judged, right? Don't you judge me. But then here's what else I do know as well. We all judge, right? Everybody is like, we all have this little referee in our heart wearing a striped jersey with the whistle, just waiting to blow the whistle and make the call on other people. And do you know why? I know that that's absolutely true, because I have a kid that plays Little League basketball, right? You should just sit like a fly on the wall and listen to parents during the game. Like, they like to make judgment about every single call that gets made, depending on whether it goes in favor of their kid or not. Like, what do you mean? That was a foul. They mauled him. Are you blind, ref? Can you, whatever, right? They get very upset, you know, just losing their mind. And so we all judge, right? We all judge. We all discriminate. And there's a time for that, right? So, you know, there for sure is a time. Have you seen these new commercials, these Just Okay, that are out right now? So Just Okay is not okay. And they've got the friends that are sitting at the restaurant, and the waitress comes out and she says something about, you know, the chef went home with food poisoning, which is never a good sign. and then they ask about the special or the sushi. I don't know what they ask about. They ask about something. And she's like, yeah, well, it's okay. Which you're like, well, then we'll not be having that. And she's like, she doesn't say this, but she's thinking, are you judging? And they're like, yes, absolutely, right? If you were to go in for surgery, right? Brain surgery, heart surgery, some type of surgery, minor surgery, whatever surgery, and then the nurse came in and say, hey, the scheduled surgeon wasn't able to make it today, but we found some dude that likes to watch Life in the ER and Chicago Meds. We think he will do an okay job. You would be like, no, right? Pass. Are you judging? Totally, right? Absolutely I am. We don't put just anyone in the cockpit of an airplane and let them fly the airplane. So we discriminate, we judge all the time, right? We just do. And there is a time for that, for sure. And there is a time when it's wrong. And so I'm gonna jump in and look at that today. And so we're gonna dive right into Jesus' words and right into Jesus' teaching. What does he have to say about the subject? It seems fairly simple, but I want you to know there are layers to what we're going to talk about. And everyone in the room, you should feel slightly convicted with today's message if you're awake and paying attention. And just so you know, welcome to my world, because I have wrestled and felt convicted and walked through this over the last couple weeks, and now I get to invite you into that. And so Jesus' target audience here, it's again these hyper religious leaders that do have the tendency to just blow the whistle and to declare whether someone or something is good or bad, right or wrong, evil, declare behavior this, and like jot it down in their little book, like, oh yeah. And I would say this, critiquing in like the worst sense of the word. And so it was highly prevalent in their day, just like it is ours. So Jesus has some words for them as well as for his followers and those people that are committed to becoming more like him. So we'll pick it up now. Chapter 7, here's what we read Jesus saying, starting in verse 1. So here it is. Do not judge, right? There you go. Or you too will be judged, for in the same way you judge others, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? How can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, when all the time there's a plank in your own eye? You hypocrite. First take the plank out of your own eye, then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. All right, so here we go. Judging, speck, sawdust, 2x4 planks. What is Jesus going, what's he up to here? So here's what I wanna do now. I wanna break this down and I wanna go like kind of back to it verse by verse and just kind of talk about what's going on. So let's start with the very first verse. He says, do not judge, or you too will be judged. And maybe you're going, all right, got it. Don't judge. It seems fairly straightforward. Let's wrap this up and go home early. Okay, I know. Pump the brakes there, because we need to understand this word judge here that is being used to get at what Jesus is dealing with when he uses the word. And so that word judge in the Greek, it just means this. It means, listen, make a distinction. That's what it's talking about. You're gonna make a distinction. It's a declaration of whether something is good or evil, whether something is right or wrong. And again, this statement by Jesus seems fairly straightforward, but I don't want you to miss the weight that's behind it, okay? This is an incredibly powerful command, because by this very thing, judging, not judging, by that very thing, people are shaped, right? You understand we shape people for reconciliation, for good, for health, or for condemnation and for hurt. So this has a lot of weight to what he's saying. Let's read a few more verses and I'll come back and unpack and talk about that. So then he goes on and says, for in the same way that you judge others, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. So are you tracking with what's going on there? He basically said that that you should expect the same standard of judgment to be applied to the judger and to the one that is being judged, right? So whatever it is you dish out, you should expect that in return. So if you're hateful, if you're harsh, if you always assume the worst, well then like a boomerang, man, like that's probably coming around back at you. So if you want to be the moral police showing absolutely no grace, right? The person, you know, gets pulled over. So hypothetical scenario, and they're like, officer, I was doing like 1 or 2 miles an hour over the speed limit. Like, I don't even have any traffic violations. And the guy's like, whatever, I don't care. You are a menace to society. If it were up to me, I would just throw you in prison and throw away the key. You're a terrible person. Sign the ticket and get out of my sight. Versus, hey, like you are moving a little bit fast, probably on your way to pick up the kids. You should, you know, slow it down and then have a great day. So he's saying, whatever option that you're taking with others, you should count on getting that in return. So like, are you looking for the ticket or the no ticket version, right? Which I would say, this should be one of the greatest, most compelling verses that you and I have for sympathy and for, you know, mercy. So that basically check yourself before you wreck yourself. And right there, That line really gets rid of it, pulls back the curtain on any idea or notion that we could judge others and then not have that come back on us in return. So it goes on and says this, gives this fun little illustration. He says, why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye. How can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, when all the time there's a plank in your own eye? So you realize that right there, this is Jesus doing comedy, right? If you're new to church, this is a little bit of theatrics, Jesus being comical. His original audience would have found this hilarious, right? And so the illustration, the imagery seems ridiculous because it's supposed to be, right? Because the imagery here, and maybe you're new to church, and maybe you're new to the Sermon on the Mount, but if you've been around church for some time, right? Maybe you've been here for a while and you've heard someone do this story, and maybe they came out, you saw the guy, you saw the lady teach this, and they got the prop. Have you ever seen someone do this? They put the prop on their head where they've got like a big 2x4, it looks like sticking from their forehead. So that the picture, right? I'm not gonna do that. But the picture is you've got some guy with a giant plank protruding from his forehead, and he comes running into the room, right? And there's someone else in the room that's got like a small piece of dust, maybe like a bug, like a gnat flew into their eye. And so 2x4 head is like, oh my goodness, you've got a bug in your eye. That is disgusting. I need to get it out, right? And so what do they do? They're like, oh, that's gross. Let me fix you. Comes running over and wham, like rams them in the face with the giant 2x4 sticking out of his head. The guy's like, oh, like, I think you just broke my nose, right? And that guy's like, oh, well, that was weird. Let's try again because I need to fix you. Wham, right? Again, 2x4 to your face. And maybe they get the bug out of your eye. Maybe they don't. But the imagery there is you end up in much worse condition than you were whenever you started. Dale Bruner says this. He says, we underassess our own faults and failures, right? And then we overvalue or overassess others' faults and their failures. So here's what happens. The temptation is often to look at other people's failures and then try to play God, right? Rather than to recognize and realize that we have our own shortcomings and our own blind spots as well. So the picture here, right? And the point here is not going, oh, look at you. You are such a terrible person, but rather, man, I've got my own stuff too, right? I've got my own areas that I need to work on. And you have to realize, as a follower of Christ, you have to live under that reality. For sure, you have to be aware of that before we move towards judging someone else. Because here's what he goes on to say next in verse 5. He says, you hypocrite, first take the plank out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from the brother's eye. So, okay, and did you catch what he's doing there? Right? Do you get what he's doing? So he is giving us ground rules, right? He's giving us guidelines for dealing with the speck in somebody else's eye, right? And so he's saying the very first thing you have to do is you have to avoid being a hypocrite, right? Wearing a mask, living a lie, if you're going to then look to dealing with someone else's sin. So deal with your own junk, right? Pride, gossip, jealousy, lust, anger, selfishness, before you look to deal with someone else's sin, right? You at least you have to be humble, and you at least have to be honest about those things in you and maybe in process. So he's saying that once you have dealt with your own stuff, right, your own sin, and only then will you be able to see clearly to not try and take the posture of God, but rather in mercy, seek to help out the other person that might have a speck or something in their eye. And this is such great stuff. And Jesus here, man, he's so brilliant, clever, awesome, because he's not even concerned with going, oh, come on, man, you need to clean up your act, right? What is wrong with you? But rather, hey, listen, you can't see clearly to help this person out until you've worked on your own stuff. You tracking? So that Jesus is more concerned, or he is concerned with both the person being judged and the judger. I mean, Jesus is just next level, right? And he's so brilliant, and this is such great stuff. You gotta give him props because he doesn't want you to do harm to yourself or to do harm to others. So he gives this really crazy, ridiculous illustration to make the point. Okay, so that's kind of what's going on here in the teaching. Now here's what I wanna do now, right? I want us to spend a few minutes talking, because there is tension, right? You have to, if you read this faithfully, there is tension in this text that is unavoidable, is there not? Because it seems to me, like the message of Jesus sort of contradicts some other sections of your Bible where we are told to evaluate the sins of people, right? For sure, people that are in the community of faith, like in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, where Paul says, you judge people in the church, and he talks about expelling the evil person or the wicked brother, right? Kick them out. Which notice how we don't tend to throw that verse around a lot, right? We love to say, hey, don't judge or you'll be judged. No one's going, kick out the immoral brother. We got to get you out of here. So again, the point being, Jesus' teaching isn't maybe as straightforward or simple as we would like to think. Not that judging's ever easy or fun. But I would say that we really have to dig in, right? Dive a little deeper into this idea of judgment to make sure we don't push too far, right? We don't want to push too far or pull up too short, right? So there's a tension in the middle ground that we have to navigate. So here's what I want to do. I'm going to move through this quickly, but I don't want you to miss the importance or the distinction that I'm going to share for the next few minutes, all right? So if you're ready, let's kind of dive into judgment. And here's the distinction I want to make, right? I want to say it this way for clarity's sake for us in the room. And here's the language we'll use. There's a difference between judgment and correction, right? And I'm just going to use those words for clarity. Judgment and correction. So first, let me talk kind of what we think judgment in the unhelpful way. Judgment is when we call out, listen, a perceived evil, right? Maybe it's an evil, maybe it's just what you perceive, or wrongdoing in another person without loving them. So you just want to be the ref. You just want to be the umpire, blow the whistle, call strike, you're out. I'm like, what? That was just strike one, right? I'm not out yet. He's like, whatever. I call you out. You're a terrible person. You got to go. So you call attention. Here's what you do. You call attention to their wrongs or their failures just simply to draw attention to their wrongs and to their failures. Right? Or maybe you even tried to make a declaration about this person's identity or their whole being that goes beyond just a certain action and to harm them. And listen, I'm not talking about, you know, a serial killer, right? Or someone that's a habitual abuser. I'm just talking a flawed, messy, sometimes selfish person like you and me. Let me give you a few other things that judgment does. Judgment is always, listen, it's always rooted in selfishness. It's always about you or self-righteousness. It has self-righteous motives. Its goal is to produce shame, right? Your intent is to get shame in the other person. It deals in absolutes, right? They always, they never, and it leaves no room for grace. And like I would say, I don't think there's anyone in this room who would deny how powerful judgment is and how it has the ability to cut deep into our most vulnerable areas. I would say this, I don't know anyone, right? Or maybe I should rather say, I think it's rare that someone is ever changed by judgment. True? Like, you know the kid that maybe has that parent that always tries to shame and guilt them and talk down to them and make them feel bad? Do you ever, this, whatever? And then that kid go, wow, like, yes, now that I feel like crap, I think I'm going to change, right? And maybe they modify behavior because of the guilt, but no real change there. And here's what's scary. Here's what I've noticed. This is, it's so subtle, right? And oftentimes, we don't even see it because it's become like it's become our autopilot. It's become kind of our go-to mode so much for many people in our culture, and they don't even recognize when they're doing it. So I would say, when's the last time you just hit the pause button and said, wow, am I judging like right now? So you realize we do things like this. We couch it in sarcasm. So we say sarcastic comments, kind of hide it there. Or we hide it behind nicisms. Some of you do this. I know we're in Texas, right? Some of you are from the South. So we use the phrase, bless their heart, right? To spiritualize or make something that's really judgmental sound nice. Oh, would you look at her? Poor thing. She will never get a man like that. Bless her heart, right? Or we played off like, I was just kidding, right? Come on. It was just a joke. Why are you being so sensitive? So I throw it out there, make you feel awful, and then I play it off like a joke. It's like the lawyer in court that says something they know they shouldn't say, then they withdraw it really quick, but you know it's already out there for the jury to hear and ponder. Here's what this is as well. So it's for me, again, it's just so weird, and it's really sad. Judgment has the power to tear down. Listen, to tear down, and again, in a perceived moment, something that was built over the course of a lifetime. So someone had a bad moment, right? So maybe it really was a bad moment for them, or maybe it is something that we perceived to be a bad moment from our vantage point, and a judgmental comment or a tweet or a post can infect the mind and completely destroy other people's behavior or perception of that person in an instant. And like some of you know this, right? And you don't care. Or maybe that's even what you hope for. And so it keeps all of us from seeing ourselves the way that God sees us, which is why this is so dangerous and why this is so powerful. It's why it is so important that Jesus would include it in some of his most important teachings on the Sermon on the Mount, right? So we have to be wise. We have to be wise and not fall into the hater category. And it doesn't mean we can't assess or we can't address other people's behavior, because Paul will say that there are times we for sure need to do that. But what he is saying is that he's calling us to be responsible, right? For how we do that without attacking someone's value as a human being, or making them feel rejected, or making them feel outcast. So this is like next level stuff. If you are a follower of Christ, this is high level, and it's what we're called to pursue and what we're called to live like. Again, a whole new way to be human. Now, what Paul is talking about and what the Bible does affirm is correction, right? So we're okay with correction. Do you have kids, right? Do you love those kids? Not if you correct them, if you don't correct them, you don't. Like we all need correction. And I know most of us in the room, we're adults, so we feel like I'm grown up now, but you're still God's kids. And so we still need correction. And you have to be, unless you've reached perfection, and if you have, come see me afterwards and I'll give you the mic. But most of us, we still have some room to grow. And so we have to be willing to receive this humbly. I read a book a while back by a guy named Brad Lominick called H3 Leader. It's about three H's that every great leader has. And he talks about you have to be hungry, right? You just have to really have a desire and a drive. You have to hustle, just actually get out there and do something with that drive and work hard. And then humble, right? You have to remain humble. He says those are the three things that make up great leaders. As well, those people that are willing to take correction are the people that are considered in scripture to be wise, right? Those that receive correction, okay, they're gonna get an abundance of fruit. Whoever's willing to receive that correction, it says, those are people that can be trusted with much. So they're wise, they're gonna get an abundance of fruit, they can be trusted because they allow God to speak into those areas that need growing them in Christ's likeness. So let me give you some more compare and contrast between correction and judgment. Here's what we do when we correct someone. We draw out wrong. So we draw out wrong and we do it in a loving way. We seek the good of the other person and we do it with humility. So if you've ever actually tried to put the work in to do this, you know how hard it is, right? It is like one of the hardest things that you will ever do, because you have to humble yourself to the reality of your own sin and your own weakness. And you have to want good for that person, even when they're making it really, really hard and difficult to want good for them, right? But it's also the most loving thing that we can do, to say, hey, there is this thing in you and it's out of alignment right now. Because again, correction always speaks to the good of the other person. And it always works in the hope of getting that person back on path with Jesus and to becoming all that they could be, right? So the correction isn't meant to push people down, right? Especially in order to bring you up. Actually, it's meant to build the person up, even if it's hard, to build them up. And often it means humbling yourself. And if it's not that, then that's judgment, right? If in speaking to and addressing someone else, your end goal is not to lead them back to Christ and into the presence of God in a deeper, richer, more fulfilling way, okay, well then that's judgment. And then I would say this. So for those of you in the room that would say that you love and that you follow Christ, then we do, we absolutely do have to receive judgment, right? In the form of correction. And I know we live in this cultural narrative, this cultural moment right now where we're like, oh, don't judge me. You do not know me, right? You do not know where I've been, what I've been through. Don't judge, only God can judge me. So we get this from celebrities, college campuses, even in the church, right? Sometimes in the church, don't judge or you too will be judged. So there's like there's tension in our current cultural narrative. I get it, but if you want to grow, right? If you want to grow, then you have to press in and you have to be willing to receive correction to become more like Christ. And can we be honest? I'll be honest. I do not receive that well initially. Like maybe you do, I don't ever, right? And if you've been here long, I've told you like I tend to have one of two reactions whenever someone wants to correct or press into me. One is really, well, since, you found a little speck, a little thing that I need to work on. How about I've got an entire like list of things you can work on, you big fat plank head, right? So just me? Okay. I'm feeling very vulnerable right now and judged. Or the other one is, you're right, I am. I'm a horrible person. I should probably just leave, right? Go live in a cave by myself and never talk to anyone again. They're like, you're being dramatic, right? Like I just ask you to clean the dishes. Hypothetically speaking, I don't know. So hopefully, right? That they would seek to correct you with humility and not be judgmental. That's what we hope for. But either way, you have to be willing to lean in and to assess, is there any truth there? And is God even trying to work on me, pursue me through them as much as I don't like it? And then this thought, we'll wrap up here. So whether you're being judged or you're doing the judging, that there are usually some areas or some issues that lend towards that cause that, right? So I really want you to think about this and where you're at. Like psychologists would tend to say that whenever we judge, it's usually because of four things. So four things, either you're insecure, scared, lonely, or seeking change, right? So four things, let's hit them real quick. So insecure. This is the person who is unhappy with themselves, and it makes them feel better to make others feel bad, right? So you feel bad about yourself, and so you start critiquing others to lower them, and maybe in the process, raise yourself up a little, not feel quite so bad. So first, just insecure. The next one would be scared. So you feel threatened, okay? Or you feel intimidated. Maybe you feel intimidated by the boss, some other kid at school, and so then you start saying judgmental things about them to make yourselves feel better. Maybe you feel threatened, right? So another coworker that you think may get the promotion you deserve and you don't want them, so now I start saying harsh things. Or maybe the new kid in school, some girl, right? You know, a couple girls hanging out and some pretty girl walks by and someone's like, she's cute. And they're like, she's a demon in a dress. She probably can't even read, right? I don't know. So out of insecurity or fear. Next thing, listen, if you feel lonely, this will spark this. So judgment is a way to connect with others through negativity. Like, I don't even have any friends. And so you jump on the criticism train of someone else to identify with other people that are being critical of them. Like, he is such a loser. So now at least I feel like I identify with a group and I'm not lonely anymore. And then finally, seeking change. So you want your life to be different, right? Maybe you want to be in a committed, like long-term relationship, and you're currently not. And so, you know, someone close to you gets engaged or whatever, and you're like, oh man, he is so not the right person for you, right? Like, oh, he's gross. You should dump him and run. And so it's almost a form of jealousy of something that's not happening in your life right now that is happening in their life that again, comes out in this form of judgment. And I know, like I get probably no one in the room struggles with any of these, okay? But maybe I do sometimes. And so what I want to draw your attention to, okay, is that all of these things, all of these are areas of pain, right? Insecure, scared, lonely, seeking change, something not going on in your life that you like, all of these are areas of pain. And if you are a follower of Christ, if you're in the room and that's your story, then you get to bring these things to him. Right? You don't have to come out where they hurt others or judge others. We get to give those to him. In order for us to get to the root and the why of judgment, you have to be aware of the triggers behind them, right? You need to see what is causing us or the person to do that thing. And one of the terrible, terrible things about judgment is it doesn't just hurt the person it's being directed towards. It always ends up hurting those around it when judgment starts coming out. And again, psychologists would say this, that when you and I judge other people, it makes us feel worse. So that it impacts your heart, it impacts your soul in a negative way. So then it just becomes a vicious cycle. So you feel worse about yourself, so then you judge someone else and you feel worse. And if you are a follower of Christ, it quenches the work of the Holy Spirit in your life. Absolutely. And I would say as well, judgment always evaluates or it always elevates stereotypes. And so if you're a person that is sick and tired of stereotypes that goes on crazy in our culture, this is a great way to combat it. Stop judging. So what do we do, right? What do we do with that? Let me give you a few things that you can do. And consider where on this list, what is it you need to work on? Number one, focus on yourself. I know you don't hear that in church often. Make it all about you. But here's what I want you to do. In the context of plank and spec, what is Jesus pressing into you, maybe today, graciously and lovingly, but that you need to deal with? Is there a sin? Is there an insecurity? A fear you have going on? Coworker, some kid at school? Bitterness still going on? Pain, right? Just some pain that you're harboring from loss, from loneliness, feeling of weakness. No, none of us like to feel weak. Feeling of failure that you need to get well in so that you could love others well, even when you're called to correct them. Because man, if you hold on to that stuff and you keep it in, it's going to come out, but not in a way that's good at all. It's gonna come out in a hurtful, damaging, judging way. So maybe he's calling you to focus on yourself and work on some stuff. How about this? You need to take your thoughts captive so that you don't get stuck on the runaway train of judgment or negativity. That stuff snowballs, right? So you have one negative thought, one judgmental thought, then it just starts picking up speed and momentum. And here's another one, and I grab another one, and then another one, and it just snowballs. So you should ask yourself, does this thought, right, that is starting to fill my head, does it honor God? Is it going to be helpful? Am I striving to build the person up and to love them or not? Because if not, man, you should punt on that thought and try again. So next, take captive thought. Then this, here's the thing you can do. Remember how it feels, because no one in the room has not felt this at some point. So remember how it feels when someone said something that was totally unfair or out of context about you. Or they just attacked you when you were having a bad moment, right? Maybe it's even a bad season in a particular low point of your life and ignored all of the good stuff that you had done. And that feels like a sucker punch to the heart and to the soul. And so remember how that felt for you when it was done to you and use it as motivation not to do it to others. And then here's the last thing I would encourage all of us, if you are a follower of Christ, look for the good and for the best in others. So we live. For sure, we live in a culture that loves to look for the worst, to find the worst, to fixate on the negative with our peers, with those we interact with, always looking for what someone's doing wrong or for a failure or for a shortcoming or where they mess up, rather than trying to love them and see them the way that God would see them. And what they could, listen, what they could become, even if they're in a rough season. So I've mentioned in here before that growing up, and I've had seasons where just serious anger issues, like just rage, anger, major insecurity, along with stubbornness and pride, which is a weird, wicked combination. And I'm just so grateful for people that didn't spotlight the shortcomings. Now I needed correction, still do at times, but they didn't spotlight the shortcomings, but rather believe the best and what it is that I could become. So I heard a guy say this recently, and I want to encourage you to take on this posture, that when it comes to negativity and to gossip and to judgment and those type of things that are so prevalent, here's what he said. He said, I want to spread like wildfire, like the plague, all the things that are good about you. And I want to swallow, or I want to absorb in me all those things that are negative. Because he said, I want to be the end of the road for things that are negative about you, and I want to be the beginning of a movement for all that is good about you. And that's my goal for you, and I hope that's your goal for each other. And listen, if your natural tendency is to just see, immediately gravitate towards the worst, then you are out of alignment with the way of Jesus. And so maybe he's pressing something on you or into you that needs healing. And it doesn't mean, listen, it doesn't mean we ignore sin and that we avoid correction. It just means we love like Christ and believe the best, and we're for each other, that we fight for and we care for and we move towards each other and we become better together. That's the heart. So here's what I want to encourage you. Where are those areas? Is there an area in your life that you've got a point of pain that is causing judgment? And where are these things that you could work on, right? What can you work on this week to become better? And if you're not a follower of Christ and you would like to know more about following him and this calling that he has for us, we would love to meet you after. Just come out to your back right, and we will have some people that would love to talk to you and tell you about Jesus. Let me pray. We'll wrap this up. Heavenly Father, we do pray for a new kind of way to be human. I pray that we would strive and do the hard work not to judge. And if there is tension, that we would fight for correction, because we want so much good for our spouse, for our kids, for our parents, for our neighbor, for our coworker, and even where they're difficult, like Christ, we would lay down our lives and love them anyhow. And that miraculously, supernaturally, God, even in that, you would continue to transform and make changes, and that we would trust you. So God, we love you. We ask these things in your son's name. Amen. All right, church, thank you for being here today. If you have a Connect card, would like to say hi to us, head out to your back right. Let us say hi to you. For the rest of you, love you guys. Have a great week. We'll see you next Sunday. Looking at my life.